Welcome to the Dump Station, a podcast from RV Enthusiast.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to the Dump Station Podcast. My name is Chris Doherty. I'm the technical director for RV Enthusiast. And today we're going to talk a little bit about a new movie that's come out called Nomadland, and it is really sweeping the movie industry. It won Best Picture in the Golden Globes here in 2021. And so we're going to have our panel discussion about that, and on our panel is going to be Bob Livingston, who is the publisher of RV Enthusiast magazine. And we're also joined by Chris Hemer, the technical editor, and Jim Mack, our director of marketing and RV Enthusiast. So before we do that, let's take a look at what Nomadland is all about.
You are one of those lucky people that can travel anywhere.
Yes, ma'am, I know.
And they sometimes call you nomads.
My mom said that you're homeless. Is that true?
No, I'm not homeless. I'm just houseless. Not the same thing, right?
No.
My husband worked at the USG mine in Empire. I was a substitute teacher.
It is a tough time right now. You may want to consider early retirement.
I need work. I like work.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Welcome to Badland Spa.
What the nomads are doing is not that different than what the pioneers did.
Hey, Fern. Gotta make the hole bigger.
I think Fern's part of an American tradition.
Oh, he's gonna come right through the glass.
My dad used to say, what's remembered lives. I maybe spent too much of my life just remembering.
One of the things I love most about this life is that there's no final goodbye. I've met hundreds of people out here, and I don't ever say a final goodbye. Let's just say I'll see you down the road. And I do. I see them again. And I can be certain in my heart, I'll see you again.
And so that book and movie is very interesting. We're going to talk about that a little bit today. And joining me first is going to be Bob Livingston, our publisher. Hey, Bob, how you doing?
I'm doing great. How you doing?
Doing well, thank you. And so you also got a chance to see Nomadland recently.
I did.
Yeah, and so a little bit of a background on the movie. The movie was based loosely on the book by Jessica Bruder called Nomadland, Surviving America in the 21st Century. And Jessica is a journalist who focuses a little bit on the people left out of the economy, the downtrodden, and some of the smaller segments of society. And that's how she got into doing this project. And it actually did make a pretty good film. And Bob, you, like I said, you recently saw it. What were your thoughts of the movie?
You know, after I saw the trailer, I got the impression of one type of, you know, traveling RV living, you know, the nomad lifestyle. You know, it's if you will, the boondocking lifestyle. And then I looked, after I saw the movie, it was like it didn't exactly, you know, come across like the trailer. And I haven't read the book yet, but I thought it was very well done, and it had a lot to say, and the acting was very, very good. But I got the feeling that when I looked at the trailer, I was saying, oh man, I'm going to go see America. I'm going to go have a good time. And you know what, you know, maybe I'm going to chuck my house and all that stuff. But what it really is, it's really a movie about someone who has met some challenging times and is looking for another way to survive. And this person has a great, you know, it's a really good, strong mindset, and she wants to do things her own way, and she's taken another avenue, and of course gets in her van and goes and travels and sees different places and works as much as she can. You know, it's not the most upbeat movie at times, but it's very real. And I thought that, you know, it really portrays how a minimalist would like to live. And that, and there are a lot of people doing that, whether it's in a van or if it's in a small travel trailer, in a small SUV or a truck. A lot of people are saying, hey, it's time to chuck all the stuff and see America. But again, you know, if you look at the trailer, you might think this is kind of an upbeat movie about go see America and do it for very little money and have a good time and meet people and all that, which you do. But, you know, the movie doesn't come across exactly the way the trailer was presented. And I'm not sure how the book was, but I'm going to read it.
So. Yeah, the book was, you know, more of a social study, if you were, of the experience, and it's focusing primarily on people who are living in their vehicle because they don't have an option. And that makes it different than common RVing. And I know in the past couple of years, a couple of things have come to light about the van life. Okay, hashtag van life. A lot of people are buying vans to go travel. But this is a little bit different than that.
It is different. And you know, like I said, it portrays some of the more challenging aspects of life, but it also shows that, you know, life isn't over because you're having these challenges. That, you know, it is all, you know how your life is spent is all perspective. I mean, you see some beautiful things and you get to have some friends and you talk to people with common issues and common goals. And so, you know, and in this case, you know, the gal who was traveling, you know, on the road, who's looking, you know, worked here and there, and to, you know, get enough money to stay on the road, had options. I mean, even in the movie, it shows in the movie that she did have some options. She didn't want to do that. She chose to be very you know, independent, and you know what, in that lifestyle, you know, it grew on her. And of course, we all know that because the RV lifestyle grows on you. That's why as close as you can connect or relate this movie to the Boondockers, people who have traveled unhooked and they want to see America. They don't want to spend a lot of money, but they also want to see things, and they have the independence. And, you know, most of the people that are living full time are not in vans or tiny little trailers, but they're in larger fifth wheels and trailers and motorhomes. But they are spending time. And like you spend time like in Quartzite, which was portrayed there in the movie.
So, you know, we're talking about boondocking, we're talking about getting off the grid. Those are very popular topics, certainly from a tech standpoint, that we address in the book. But it's very popular with people because we have the natural resources to go out and spend time, whether it's in the desert or Quartzite or in the national parks, or national forests, whatever. It does allow people to have that experience. You know, they spent time at some places that I know you're familiar with, Wall Drug, Quartzite. How were those portrayed in the movie compared to the real life experience?
In that part, I was a little bit disappointed in, because if you're not initiated, if you don't really know about the boondocking lifestyle, if you haven't been to Quartzite, and if you haven't been to the places like the Badlands and other places, there are places all over the country that are like that. You probably get the impression that the people who are going to like Quartzite are really down and out. And that's not the case. You know, there are people there that are struggling financially and on hard times and they're living there, but it's really a nice place. I mean, Quartzite is, if you look at the landscape, it's really a nice place to be. Most of the people that go there are having a good time spending their winter there because they want to get away from the cold weather. And they're really into the boondockings. Once you get boondocking into your blood, you know, I had a very dear cousin of mine who went boondocking for maybe 15 years. And, you know, one time I had him come to my house when we're full timers now, so we don't have a house, but they came to my house one time and they said, and I said, hey, I got some space for you. And I've dragged out a power cord. And they go, well, I don't want that. And we don't do that. You know, they just like to, they like the independence. And so once you get that into your blood, you really like that, you know, traveling to primitive places unhooked. Some of the most beautiful places on earth are unhooked. You'd be unhooked. And so anyway, so back to that, I wish they would have shown a little bit more of conventional type RVs, people out in the desert. Of course, that wasn't what the movie was all about. The movie, you know, definitely had a theme, and they followed that theme, you know, pretty much throughout the movie. So,
anyway. And of course, the other aspect to this, before we bring the rest of the panel in, we talk a little bit more about boondocking and that type of thing, is work camping. So there are a lot of opportunities that have been for a long time. I remember, you know, I was a work camper during my years full-timing. I managed an RV park and did RV service. I've known a lot of people who are work campers over the years. Of course, that whole idea has kind of transformed a little bit, and there's some different opportunities today.
Great opportunities. I mean, whether you want to be, host at a campground, or you want to work in a facility like they showed on the movie, you know, in Amazon. There are a lot of places, seasonal, jobs, whether it be the winter or summer. Work camping is a great way to go. I mean, my wife Lynn and I, our goal is to one day do some work camping to give back to public lands. We want to go in there. We don't want to be paid, and they don't pay anyway. All we want to do is be able to spend a whole season someplace and just give back to the places that gave us so much, joy over the years, and that was, we cut our teeth on going to primitive campgrounds in the national forests and national parks and state parks and all that. So we want to give back to that. So that's one aspect of it. The other aspect of work camping is, hey, it pays expenses. You can make some money. And I know people that work all summer long, and they come home with a lot of money, and they've had a great time, and they met great people. Yeah, they work hard, but they've had a great time.
It is hard work. A lot of the places you go, whether it's, Amazon work for your camper force, working at Amazon, especially during the holiday season, or the beet harvest or different things like that. There's some of the opportunities are very hard. Certainly working at a campground on holiday weekends is nothing to shake a stick at. It can be a lot.
No, it's not. No, yeah. I had really good friends that used to work camp every single year. And they were fairly well off. They did not need to work camping, for the money. And I said to him, "Hey, why do you do that? Why would you put all that effort out?" And he goes, "Because it's the best social life we could have. We meet so many fantastic people.
Sure.
And we're camped with people all season long that we become friends with and make lifelong friends. And then we meet all these new people, people coming into wherever they worked. I mean, they worked in Alaska. They worked at Wall Drug. They worked in campgrounds. Hey." They meet a lot of people and they love it. And so the social aspect is for them was unbeatable.
Absolutely. And it comes back to the idea that, RVers and the RVing lifestyle, whatever level you're at, and it has the same kind of, it reflects the same socioeconomic realities that are throughout society, right? But when you come to a campground, or you're at a rally, or you're at Quartzite, or you're one of these things, those barriers disappear, and everybody is an RVer, which is one of the great things about the lifestyle.
Absolutely.
Let's bring in our other guests here. So I'm going to bring in Chris Hemer. Chris is our technical editor for RV Enthusiast magazine, and Jim Mack, who is a longtime RVer, and he heads up all our social media stuff. Gentlemen, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you, Chris.
Good to be here. Mm-hmm.
So we've been talking here a little bit about Nomadland and the movie and the book from that standpoint, and that leads us into a conversation about boondocking with your RV. And so, today's RVs are being built in such a way they can handle four seasons better. We've seen a lot of that. They're actually building them now with some boondocking capabilities like solar and better insulation so they can handle, again, the four seasons. So let's talk a little bit about that, Chris. What are some of the things people could be considering for adding to their rig?
Well, first of all, if they're considering purchasing a rig, they should look at one that's already designed for four season camping, which generally means heated holding tanks, or at least heating pads on the tanks. Enclosed storage, so the storage compartments are all warmed with the furnace. In some, Bob Livingston noted a while ago, some four season packs don't have dual pane windows, which kind of negates the whole idea of, you know, really being able to camp four season. So that's another thing that you want to look out for. If you don't already have that, there's a few things that you could do for four season camping. You can, adding additional insulation isn't really viable, but you can do things like insulate your skylights and your hatches, you can purchase them online. They're like pads. They're generally one size that fits the hatch of an RV, pretty easily. There's, what's that, Bob? What was the name of that film that you said you can put over windows?
That stuff, that's the insulation film. It's a plastic film that you put on the windows, and you can use it's like a heat shrink for the windows, and you can put them over there. And it actually worked pretty well for in cold weather.
Do you remember the name of that? I can't recall it right now.
Oh, man. Oh, God. What was the name of that?
Well, they sell that at Home Depot or Lowe's at your home center. Frost King makes it.
Frost King
window film. Yeah. And so it's you hard can to see. That, yeah. Thereby, you're creating sort of a dual pane window. And also you can still see light through it, which if you just put some sort of insulation in the window, you're living inside of a dark cave, basically. Also, if you're living someplace really, really cold, then or staying someplace really, really cold, you want to consider a heated water hose and being able to keep the dump hose also warm with exterior heat or something like that. And Chris, you also had great tips on having that transfer pump. So an extra hose and a transfer pump. So if your hose does freeze, you can get that other hose out and you can still pump water into your rig through that transfer pump and also a collapsible water bladder that you can keep in your tow vehicle and things like that. So there's a lot of things you can do. And those are things that we're going to continue to talk about in RV Enthusiast to help people in the off season. And as we work into the warmer season, things that we can do at that time as well.
Go ahead, Bob.
Well, I was going to say for me, I know this sounds, because it may sound silly to people, but the challenge of living off the grid is a lot more fun than plugging in is great. I mean, but there's nothing to it. You just plug in, you got everything hooked up, and you do it. But the challenge, RVs are self-contained. That's what they're designed to be, self-contained, to be used without being hooked up. Now, of course, most people do hook up because of the experience in the campgrounds and stuff, which is a great thing to do.
And it's convenient.
But the fun thing, I know this sounds crazy, but I mean, I remember going out to temperatures that are way, way, even below zero with an RV and saying, hey, let's see if we can, how long we can go before we freeze up, you know, or see how long we can go and before we get too cold and using the systems. And it's not just winter. I mean, it's summer travel and it's shoulder seasons also. It gives you a lot more versatility. You're on the road, you need a place to stay. It's nice to know that you can stay, have all your systems working without being hooked up. There's a little bit of a thrill there. It's a thrill to watch your gauges on with your solar system to see, ooh, man, my batteries are coming back. And in a couple hours, I'm going to have my batteries back to where they were before. Now I can watch TV all night and I could make my coffee and all this stuff, working off my power inverter and batteries. And I'll get the batteries back in the morning, you know. And it's just something about that. I know it sounds silly, but it's just there's something about that.
Everything I learned about camping was from my dad. And my dad was exactly that, cut from the same cloth. He was a minimalist from day one. I mean, we tent camped, and then when I was born, he bought a travel trailer because that way I would, be comfortable as a little kid. But as soon as I was a teenager, he got rid of the travel trailer and got a tent trailer again.
Yeah.
And he delighted in the fact that he bought the cheapest tent trailer there was. It had nothing in it. Mm-hmm. And this was before the big box stores, but he went to the local hardware store, bought some plywood, bought some laminate, built a cabinet, and bought one of those little pump handle.
With a
small faucet on it that you get in a water purification system like that size. And a collapsible water bladder on a shelf in there. And then he took a hole saw and cut a hole in the floor. So when we ran water in the thing, It just went down through the hole and on the ground. You know, it was just wash your hands. Nothing like detergent or anything like that. And he just, you know, he was like, look at this. Look, we have a sink now. You know, the most exciting thing in the world. And then, you know,
water running
tank stove. And he got this little tiny, thing that held a utility candle. It was like you hung it up and it held a single utility candle in there. So there's enough light in the tent so you can get around, but we don't have to burn anything, you know? And it's like, okay, Dad, cool. That's, that's awesome. But I mean, he would have just been like, no, what do we need all that stuff for?
Well,
stereos and all that. What do we need that for?
Well, let's talk about something boondocking. And Chris, you'll relate to this story. And Bob, you've boondocked a lot. You've camped without. I have a small Class C with a generator, and usually I'm plugged in somewhere. My wife really likes hookups. But last July, we spent about 18 days at a national forest campsite in Pennsylvania. No hookups, no water. There were about 8 sites there. Nobody had cell service. There was really nothing. And I remember, Chris, when I went into town, texting you after about 10 days and saying, hey, Chris, I run my generator 2-3 hours a day now, and my batteries don't seem to ever get full. You know, they're only 1-year-old batteries. What should I do? Should I put a automotive battery charger on the batteries along with the generator charging? And I got a text back, I think the next day we went back into town, from Chris that said, well, you need better batteries and a better inverter charger. That's what you need. And you know, those are that's something. Yes, you buy from the factory self-contained and you don't have to plug in to a point, but it's those kind of things that I never thought about until I was really using my batteries over the course of almost 2 weeks, thinking, geez, you know, there's got to be a trick to this. And what are those tricks? And I think we've got something coming up in a next issue of RV Enthusiast that would help me get my RV ready for longer boondocking stays.
We very definitely do.
Yep, absolutely. And the technology, you know, and certainly, Chris, you talk about, you know, your experience as a minimalist. And I grew up both with, you know, we had an RV. I grew up in a horse farm. We had an RV since I was 3. But I, of course, we didn't. That was mostly for going to shows and stuff like that. So we didn't really take many other trips with it. But I would go out with a tent, you know, sometimes and do, I did a fair amount of tent camping as a kid because it was, I lived out in the country. It was easy to go out and go in the woods or go wherever and have some fun with that.
Tent camping is great when you're young and you can sleep on hard things and
you live on that quick.
Yep. And the first couple of rainstorms and it soaks through the tent and whatever else, then you're starting to get a different idea about it, but that's all part of the adventure.
Right.
And then later, a friend of mine I come from the fire service, friend of mine from Yonkers Fire Department, I restored an old Coleman pop-up camper. And
that's what it was.
Wasn't Sunbrella back then. It was, you know, just regular, you know, tarp material. And, of course, it
like
wasn't
waterproof, wasn't it? So. Like that kind of sort of thick, almost like waxed cotton type.
Yeah. It was a little bit newer than that, but still the seams and things. It wasn't like the Sunbrella fabric that they use today. And we went out to, I remember a bunch of us went out to Cape Cod with that and a couple of trucks. And yeah, the rain came down like a son of a gun. It was October. We got drenched and frozen all at the same time at Nickerson State Park. But, you know, it's all part, that's all, you know, part of the fun. But today, people are living in their RVs and working full time in them. So there's a lot of technology. There's a lot of things that really can help out with being on the road and working from the road.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, things have changed. I mean, in the old days, we used to, I don't want to date myself, but in the old days, and you know, in order to keep the system's working, which meant, i.e., if you're camped, like when we used to snow camp with our trailers and motorhomes and all that stuff, before there was sophisticated electronics and solar systems and you know, portable generators and all that, we just put in a 8-gauge charge line from the engine and hooked them up to, direct to the batteries, and then put a rock on the accelerator and charged the batteries. And hey, you know, we used the golf cart batteries and it worked. But, and, you know, to answer your question, Jim, you need to make sure that you have a charger that's a multi-stage charger that's efficient. So then, because you're not going to get the charging directly from your generator, it's not going to happen. And if you have a converter that's not a multi-stage, charger, you're not going to get the capacity that you need for a shorter period of time. And so if you want, in your case, you may have to go out and get an external a charger, you know, like the True Charge 40 from Xantrex. That's a really good unit. I used to use that as a portable. I still use it as a portable for certain situations. And you can hook that directly into your generator, and you'll get a very efficient, very quick charging. And either that or, you know what, you can spring for a solar system, and that'll help you out too. I mean, in my own rig, we have a very sophisticated solar system and inverter and lithium batteries and the whole bit. So, you know, we're self-sustainable for a long period of time. I mean, the only thing that we have to deal with is water. And like Chris talked, I think which Chris it was, but talked about the bladder. We use a small waterbed bladder, and we pump water into our rig. And then we only have to figure out what to do with the gray water. And, you know, a lot of times you can get away with a blue boy and dump it.
Blue Boy is a portable tank with wheels.
Right, a portable tank. And you have to be very, you have to conserve your water, but it works. And so, the thing to me is, and you talk about, Chris was talking about his father and being a minimalist, which is a great thing, because a lot of people love being, you know, just seeing how they can get by with the least amount of effort and stuff. And for me, it's how do I continue to be as comfortable as I want to be without being hooked up? And that's the challenge that I like. And so when I get out in the middle of nowhere, and if I'm unhooked, I don't want to give up anything I got going. I mean, you can't, unless you have a big generator, you're not going to run your air conditioners for a long period of time without hookups. But forget the air conditioners, everything else in my rig works when we're unhooked. And to me, that is exciting because we're not giving up any of the luxuries afforded by a recreation vehicle. But we don't have to be, dependent upon being hooked up. We have the option. We spend most of our year in campgrounds and resorts because we enjoy doing that. But we also have, there's also a segment of the year that we like to be, out there on our own. And so get best of both worlds.
I think the thing that a lot of people need to remember also or recognize is that the average RV is designed for the average person who goes out about, what, 3 or 5 times a year on a family vacation for a few days. And so they don't need the best batteries, and they don't need the best inverter charger, and they don't need the best solar system, because they're just average RVers. And so when you have beyond average needs, those systems aren't going to work. It's not that there's anything wrong with the systems. They're just not designed for someone that is going to be in their RV several months at a time, maybe in extreme environments, maybe without hookups. So when you have a different kind of lifestyle, you need to equip that vehicle accordingly. It's kind of like, if you go buy a four-wheel drive SUV, it's designed for the average person that's going to drive in rain and snow, and they're going to go down dirt road. But if you plan to do some really hardcore work with it, going rock crawling and in the backcountry and everything, you're going to have to outfit it with better suspension, bigger tires and wheels, some sort of a cargo rack. And the same thing's true of your trailer or your motorhome. If you're using it beyond the average, then you there's things to upgrade, and those are things that you should consider. And you're not really going to find out what you need unless you do like Jim did, take your new RV out and stay in it for a few weeks and find out
what doesn't work.
Oh, I really need a better furnace, or I need to change the ducting, or I need better batteries, or I need the inverter's not up to task, or I need more batteries in a solar system. So that's really the best way to find out what you need. Once you get what you buy, you need to consider that really as kind of like a starting point.
Yeah. Well, let me be clear. We loved the Boondocking. It was a fabulous location. It was nothing but forest around there. And I was surprised that new batteries could do that. You know, you don't really think about it until you run it through its paces. And then all this stuff and you read and hear about how people are equipping their RV for boondocking, you realize why they're doing it. You know, until it affects you, it doesn't seem like it's needed.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
Well, you know what? Batteries are great, but they do need to be recharged. They don't last forever.
In the newer technology, lithium iron phosphate batteries are very popular today. They charge more quickly. They have more stable power for a longer period of time.
Discharge zero, right?
Yeah.
And they
do require a special charge rate to work properly, which requires a different type of charger, a different charger setting. Mm-hmm. And that's something that's important to remember, is that when you're purchasing a converter or an inverter, I don't recommend just plain converters. It would be like a converter charger, an inverter charger, which is a multi-stage or designed for one that's designed for lithium that may not be the same charging rate. But those are come in varying amperage levels. And so obviously a charger that can put out greater amps, a larger, more robust charger, is going to recharge the batteries more quickly when they're hooked up to a generator or whatnot. One quick thing before we go, Jim, I know you went out to a forest, it was a Forest Service facility in Pennsylvania. There are lots of different places you can go today, right? That you can spend time off the grid, and some newer options with whether it's national forests or national parks, or you can stay at wineries and farms and things like that, right? You can do that too nowadays.
Right. There's a lot of places to stay, and we chose this place, frankly, because it was a later reservation, almost last minute. It was over the 4th of July weekend. Campgrounds were full. And I knew this part of the country. I knew this national forest. It was first come, first serve. We got there before the weekend started. And, you know, it was tremendous. And it was honestly worth the fear of running out of electricity just to be able to stay there. And we're going back again that same time this coming year, because we liked it so much. And I'll probably plan better and maybe upgrade some of my hardware so that I don't have to get up at 3 a.m. and push that button and see where my battery's at.
Well, and I don't know if we've mentioned that, but the upcoming issue, the April issue of RV Enthusiast, is going to deal with a lot of that stuff. We're going to talk about inverters, inverter chargers, battery technology, a lot of the things that people want to know about if they're going to camp off the grid for more than a few days.
Okay. You know what's really exciting? Stuff's what? Available. There's so much new stuff available and so much effective, efficient, you know, componentry that's available.
It's amazing.
It's getting better every day, and the prices are getting more reasonable every day, and it's making it so much easier to outfit an RV for the versatility of being with, you know, being off the grid or on the grid, whatever. You have that versatility, and I think that's important, especially today. Hey, let's face it. There's a big demand for campsites, and you got to be on your game if you want to make sure that you have your reservations. And so you got to have that versatility that, hey, if you can't get in tonight, maybe you'll have to spend a night someplace, you know, in a primitive type setting, on your way to the campground the next day. But the stuff is available, and that's so exciting. I mean, you know, years ago we didn't have that kind of choices
in RVs,
so much.
You know, you've got so many different choices in RVs depending on what you want to do.
Absolutely, it's fun.
I think my next one, I'm actually thinking my next one of being a van, not a Class B, but a camper van, basically, where you have a modular kitchen in it, and you still can use it for cargo. Just from the standpoint of, I'm very spontaneous. I'm the kind of person that, you know, wakes up on Friday morning and goes, man, it'd be great to go to the mountains this weekend. But of course, there's no way because all the campsites are taken. But there's so much national forest property out there. Mm-hmm. And if you have a van that can go, that doesn't even need a site, it needs a little, you know, turnout off of a dirt road somewhere in the woods. And if I have solar and I have a good, you know, pair of lithium batteries and an inverter and stuff like that, I can watch TV, I can cook, I can do whatever I want to do for as long as I want, and then leave. And there's so much freedom in that. But, you know, it's really all about the however you like to RV, you know, if you want to tour. And,
you know, guys, maybe in an upcoming issue, we can do some tips on how to find those alternate sites.
No, we better not.
That's a really good idea.
Yeah, don't tell anybody.
Hey, we're going to tell our secrets? Hey,
yeah, no.
we got some great secrets out there. No.
So, public service.
Yeah.
Public service. That's it. Public service.
Okay. Yep. And that's one of the things, Chris, you know, you talk about vans. And Class B motorhomes for a long time, they were like a conversion van, a limousine, right?
They were.
So low to the ground, low fairings, whatever else, you know,
couldn't
do a lot with it other than just get on the highway with it.
Mm-hmm.
We have four-wheel drive vans now. You don't have to have a Quigley 4x4 upfit for $12,000.
Oh, yeah. Four-wheel drive Sprinter or Transport.
Yeah, they're all out there.
And in fact, Ford is even offering packages on the Transport for upfitting for RVing. So stronger front axle, et cetera, et cetera. I'm looking around at different companies now. There's a company called Van Do It. There's another company out of Golden, Colorado. The name escapes me right now, but they will go all the way up to and including, you know, different suspension, wheels and tires, you know, a push bar in the front, exterior lighting, in addition to your state-of-the-art lithium batteries, charger, solar, where you can, it starts to get more and more exciting when you consider the possibilities. And by the way, that van can still tow like 5,000 pounds. Mm-hmm. So if your friends go, gosh, I'd love to go camping, or your family says it would be great to go camping, but all you got is a stinking van, well, we can get a travel trailer and pull that behind it too. And then you've got all kinds of options. And
A couple of years ago, I got an opportunity to spend some time with a Winnebago Revel, and you know, which is it is designed specifically for that kind of off-road, off-grid use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and we did it at a park here in Massachusetts that at one time was a ski resort, and so they had converted the side of the mountain into campsites, and so they had roads that went up there. Well, we did the test in winter, and we had a thaw. There was still a lot of snow on the mountain. So photo shoot, let's do it. Practicing four-wheel drive, went over a snowbank, and I went right up the mountain with that thing. Got some great shots with it, but boy, I'll tell you what, I was giddier than heck.
Yeah.
You know, driving, here I'm driving this Winnebago motorhome up these snowy dirt paths up a mountain. You know, to the
you can go anywhere you want.
Yeah.
I want to thank you guys for giving me the hitch. I now need to get on the road for talking about this. So I'm ready.
I've had the hitch for a while. And I'm up in Massachusetts. Winter isn't very nice here. So, it's March, and we're all
everybody's
over there.
Got spring fever now. I think everybody's
time to get on the road.
Between the pandemic and that, and we've been cooped up too long. So time to get out in the road and enjoy a little bit. Okay, gentlemen, thank you. Bob Livingston, Jim Mack, Chris Hemer. I'm Chris Doherty for RV Enthusiast. Thank you very much for joining us. For more information on RV Enthusiast Magazine and to subscribe, come on over to our website at www.rventhusiast.com. Thanks, and we'll see you next time.
Bye, everybody.
Have a good one. Take care.
See you.